The endocrinologist told, stop this drug, don't continue. Once the drug was stopped, patient getting recurrent episodes, then referred to us. It was practically the same just like I showed previously, AVNRT with bundle branch aberrancy. It was treated completely, patient went home. Only medication for DCM, not any medication for arrhythmia. So it's a completely, it's a curable treatment. So we need not put the patient on any toxic medication like amiodarone, which is going to create lifelong problem. Other common problem which we see is WPW syndrome, which we all know this terminology from our previous days. It's a, apart from the normal conduction system, there is an accessory pathway, unnecessary conduction system, which allows the impulse to go from atria to ventricle, from ventricle to atria also. In both the directions, it can allow the impulse to go. 6% and 0.3% of the population. And it creates some risk of sudden cardiac death also. So it creates ECG shows, even that's why the importance of taking one simple ECG in your practice. Then the ECG, if somebody comes palpitation, even when you when they're visiting your clinic, when they don't have palpitation also, if the baseline ECG shows the evidence of pre-excitation, that is the presence of accessory pathway. It's understood the patient must be getting short runs of PSVT, that could be the cause for the palpitation. So it gives a slurring of the upstroke, is called delta wave, due to because the ventricle is activated from the two sources. The impulse goes to the normal conduction also, from the accessory pathway also. So the ventricle is activated from the two sources. So it produces, shortens the PR interval and produces slurring, upstroke slurring is called delta wave. So what happens when the impulse goes to the normal conduction? It comes back to the accessory pathway to the atria and forms a re-entry circuit. It forms a very fast heart rate around 140 to 260. So it presents the ECG like this. So very, this is alternate ECG alternate. So you can see the one complex and there is a difference in the amplitude, electrical alternance. This is, and with the CT changes, which is sometimes the very classical of this presence of this accessory pathway. Again, what you can do for this emergency, if you come across, can give IV adenosine, or if you don't know the presence of the, you can adenosine or calcium channel blockers or beta blockers. If you know patient is already having baseline ECG is available, patient is having pre-exhalation, you can avoid adenosine, you can prefer the calcium channel or beta blockers. You can, or carotid sinus muscles also, it's fine. You can terminate this tachycardia. But what is the long-term treatment? Already from the birth onwards, pre-exhalation is there. So patient is going to get recurrent episodes. So how are you going to treat in long term? The commonest pathway usually located in the left lateral side. This is the commonest accessory pathway. What we'll do is we'll take the catheter, ablation catheter, we'll map that area, we'll give radio frequency energy and destroy that, remove that pathway. So the patient is get cured of that. Once you remove the pathway, so patient is almost cured of that problem, goes home without any medication. Is the one another 55-year-old female with presented to the emergency with the syncope. When the patient reaches the emergency, this was the ECG. Very bizarre looking ECG. Some of the complex are narrow, some are wide, it's very irregular RR interval. This also, it's not very rare thing. Sometimes you come across, this is due to atrial fibrillation with the pre-excitation. Or for unknown reason, these patients are pre-excitation patients, are known prone to develop atrial fibrillation. But unlike AV node, which has a decremental property, the atrial rate goes up. It will not allow the too many impulses go to the ventricle. It protects the ventricle from bombardment from the atria. But this accessory pathway doesn't have that decremental property. So when the atrial fibrillation develops, it allows the more impulse go to the ventricle. So it is when the ventricle rate goes up, it goes to ventricular tachycardia and ventricular fibrillation, and patient dies suddenly. So this is how the WPW syndrome patient dies suddenly. Even at the age of patient was absolutely asymptomatic, even up to 55 years, she developed this problem. So patient promptly, because patient presented with hypotension with this bizarre ECG, she was cardioverted. Post cardioversion ECG shows the presence of pre-excitation. You can see the slurring, short PR of the slurring. You can see the classical short PR of the slurring of upstroke. And there is a small negative delta in lead 2, lead 3 AVR. So this sometimes people mistake is an infarction of old, pseudo-MA pattern. People think that is a old MI. So it's not MI, it's a pseudo-MA pattern, it's the pre-excitation. So after the RF ablation, the QRS becomes normal. You can see the disappearance of the Q wave and all this, the slurring, everything is disappeared. Even the amplitude, everything changes. it becomes normal. So we can remove the axillary pathway, so patient goes home without any medication. There is no leg threatening problem due to atrial fibrillation, past ventricular rate. This patient, like, through transseptal puncture, he just entered the left atrium and delivered the left posterior area. So patient destroyed the axillary pathway. So this is a re-entry circuit, this axillary pathway. So we can deliver radiofrequency energy in the axillary pathway, we can remove the axillary pathway. So this success rate almost 95 to 99%, it's a complication rate less than 1%. You can see the how the ECG changes. Once we burn that area, they disappears. It's a QRS totally changes because the ventricle is going to activate it through the only one source, not from the two source. So next, to go to the next set of arrhythmia. This is another patient, is a female patient, severe LV dysfunction presented with heart failure. This was the ECG taken. So, there is a clue in the ECG. So the heart rate is not very fast, it's around 135-140. So, but the P, you can see the P wave. It's a P wave, we carefully see if it is a P wave morphology are different from the sinus rhythm ECG. The P wave is totally negative from V1 to V6 and predominantly negative in inferior leads, also lead 2, lead 3 and AVF, which we don't expect in sinus rhythm. So these are all ectopic tachycardia. When the impulse originating up, not from the sinus node, it from anywhere else in the atria, either right atrium or left atrium, it's called ectopic atrial tachycardia, any site other than the sinus node. So this incessant tachycardia, continuously any tachycardia, irrespective of ventricle or atrium, it runs quite long time, it's more than 12 hours per day. If it's incessantly running, the patient is untreated, it goes into LV dysfunction. That is called tachycardiomyopathy. So this patient, probably because of this continuous incessant running of this tachycardia, she developed severe LV dysfunction and congestive heart failure. So you should not be mistaken as because of congestive heart failure, patient is having tachycardia. It's ectopic tachycardia is creating congestive heart failure and tachycardiomyopathy. So we have to take care of the tachycardia. So just this we do the three-dimensional mapping. So once we go for complex arrhythmias like beyond the re-entry circuits like tachycardia, we do three-dimensional mapping. So what we do in three-dimensional mapping is, so we can reconstruct the anatomy of the AV chamber which we are interested. So we can touch the multiple spots in that chamber, say for example here right atrium, this is the SVC, this is the IVC. So we can touch multiple spots, we can create a geometry of right atrium. This is the round is the tricuspid annulus. So it will give us, the color coding indicates where is the arrhythmia is originating, earliest site. It gives the anatomical as well as electrical activity of that particular chamber. So even without using the fluoroscopy, we can create a map that is called three-dimensional map. So this gives where it is originating and we can deliver the energy exactly in that spot and destroy that spot so that arrhythmia will be cured of that spot. So this patient, after eliminating that spot where it was originating, inferior tricuspid annulus, so patient recovered sinus rhythm and reverted to normal LV function after 3 months. So she was absolutely no medication after 3 months. It's a totally curable problem. So this sort of arrhythmia should be recognized and treated. Another common problem is atrial fibrillation. This is the commonest arrhythmia worldwide. So which every one of us would have seen this patient coming to us with atrial fibrillation, which I need not show any ECG, which is easy to recognize. So the approach is a lot of controversies, whether it should go for rate control or rhythm control. If you are decided to specialist will take care which patient needs rate control. The symptomatic patients, we should try first rate control, giving beta blockers, calcium blockers, and the patient is not responding, rate is not controlled, or rate is under control but patient is still symptomatic, then one should try for rhythm control by cardioversion and maintain the rhythm with the beta blocker or any anti-arrhythmic agents. But still patient is, we can have the option of ablation also nowadays for atrial fibrillation. This is recently coming, it's more and more getting approved and more results are coming with the AFib ablation. Previously only other which I showed previously was commonly done. AFib was thought that it's very difficult to ablate. Nowadays we are doing AFib ablation also. So this is the map. This is a three-dimensional map which shows the left atrium, which we have the latest equipment, Carto 3. We can construct the image which I showed. The left atrium is constructed here. So you can see the pulmonary veins and right pulmonary vein, left pulmonary vein. This is a left atrial map. So we can deliver the energy around the pulmonary vein. So what is the mechanism of atrial fibrillation? One of the proposed mechanism is the impulse ectopic foci origin pulmonary vein, which goes come to the atria and creating the atrial fibrillation. So once we isolate the pulmonary veins, then we can reduce the chance of getting atrial fibrillation. So what we do is we deliver energy around the pulmonary veins, and then we'll isolate the pulmonary veins from the left atrium. So further we need to create a geometry. So where is the pulmonary vein is, where is the left atrium, where it is joining. All these things we can do by mapping and deliver the energy. What we are seeing red spots are, we deliver energy around the pulmonary vein or. So we electrically we isolate the pulmonary vein from the left atrium. This is a three-dimensional mapping you can see. We can delineate the where it is joining and delineate the radio frequency energy around the pulmonary vein. So which isolate the pulmonary vein. So it gives success rate of fairly around 70%. It's not like other arrhythmias gives 100% or 95% result. It gives only 70% result because we know it's a complexity involved in the atrial fibrillation. So it's around, especially it works well for those who are paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, otherwise structurally normal heart. So normal LV function, those patients are likely to get benefit, normal LV size, those are likely to benefit with the AFib population. So not only atrial arrhythmias, we do radio frequency ablation for ventricular arrhythmias also. This is a structurally normal heart, 25-year-old male with RAT. So RPV morphology of the left axis is a ventricular tachycardia, which is a common tachycardia called idiopathic left ventricular tachycardia. So this can be managed in the emergency with giving isopin, that is verapamil, IV verapamil. This other name is verapamil sensitive tachycardia. We give IV verapamil usually structurally normal heart with a young patient, introversus sinus rhythm. So, but what is the long term treatment, especially those who get recurrent episode at the age of 25 years? So, we are not planning to put lifelong medical management for this patient to advise them for calaptin, take calaptin for lifelong. We go for radio frequency ablation, it comes from the left posterior fascicle region, we deliver that energy and we'll destroy that small re-entry circuit. So patient, we can live without success rate of more than 90% and patient can live without any medication. Is a another patient, a 22-year-old female with a recurrent episodes of palpitation, especially associated with giddiness and episodes of syncope. This is an engineer working with Infosys. So when I put on, there is no documented ECG. When I put her on treadmill, she had already ventricular tachycardia when she was doing exercise. So what is the option? There she has to take, when exercise is precipitating arrhythmia, that she has to take beta blockers for long time, unmarried girl, how long she can take beta blockers. So that is a question. So other option is when they are getting recurrent episodes, try to locate the arrhythmia, it's from the RUOT region. Otherwise structurally normal heart. So deliver radio frequency energy and map that and deliver radio frequency energy and destroy that spot so that patient can live without any medication. So not only VT, VF also we can ablate some of the VF induced by the BPCs. You can see the QRS complex very closely even before the T wave. You are not able to see the T wave here. There is VPC is falling over the T wave, so R and T phenomenon. So sometimes it precipitates VF also. The patient otherwise structurally normal heart. They just present with the recurrent episodes of syncope. It reverts spontaneously to normal sometimes. So if, unless we recognize this, don't recognize this VPC. If you neglect that, patient may die on such episode. So we map that VPCs, where it is coming from, we deliver energy and take care of that VPC so that the VF will not occur. So what are the benefits of this curative ablation therapy? Definitely quality of care. Most of the tachycardias can be treated and cured by catheter ablation. So patient eliminates the necessity of taking lifelong medication, especially younger patients. So these are the considerable number of younger patients are suffering this problem. We can avoid them giving medications for lifelong. And quality of life is much better. So they do not take any break from their working place.